I'd like to speak to you today. I think this is the perfect audience to speak to about hypothetical situations, because you're still in college, you're designing concepts, you don't really know where it's going to go from here. And I graduated from architecture school undergrad in 2009.
And then I went to New York and I did my master's. But in the 5 years that I did my architecture here, almost every single project that we started to work on, our professors would tell us, make sure that you dream as big as possible, because once you get into the real world, it won't be possible. You'll have to design bathrooms or staircases. You have to spend your time doing less than ordinary work, right? And it would always throw me off for a big loop, and I hated it. I hated the fact that we had to do that. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to take you through four projects, right? All four of these projects started as hypothetical situations and are now being built for the real world. And I want to tell you the power of a hypothetical situation. Now, I started at the age of 6 because my father was in construction, so every summer holiday or whenever I got the chance, I would spend it at construction sites, learning how to use the machinery, speaking to laborers, understanding how a building came together. And from a very young age, I knew that this is what I wanted to do. Right? So what happens is, fast forward, slide. I went to RV to do my architecture. And in my third year of architecture school, so I was 19, I heard about this competition to design concepts for a hospital. Right? And I knew nothing about hospital design. And I decided I'll take part. Did a little research, worked on it for a couple of months, and then I submitted the proposal. And a week later, we hear back from them saying, you won the competition. Okay, no. Let me get to the good part. So, 19-year-old kid, never did anything about hospitals, ended up winning this competition. It was only for concepts. They called back a month later, saying, listen, we love the concept so much, we want you to come on board and help us build it. I was like, are you serious? I don't have an architecture license, I don't have anything. And I don't even know how to use AutoCAD. Because at that time, we were discouraged from using AutoCAD. Everybody wanted to, hand draw. So students being students, we'd go home in glass trace. You guys still do that? Still do GT? No? All right. So I had to teach myself AutoCAD and all the different softwares during the day or at night. And what I did was, I didn't go back to the books to research hospital design. Slide. I spent a year in hospitals, one whole year, different hospitals, interviewing doctors, interviewing nurses, hospital staff, patients, asking them what they thought was wrong with hospital design and what they liked. Right? After this entire year, we sat together, put all the concepts together, started the drawings, slide, started construction. Now, at that time I just turned 20, so for a 20-year-old, this is not a small hospital, it's a 300 crore hospital, right? A 1,500 bed hospital, and one kid was designing the entire thing. That much faith put upon me, and I was always a confident person, so I was like, yeah, I'll do it, I have an office, I have this, I have that. And in fact, all I did have was a laptop in my bedroom. So we learned, and then, it came to the point where the building was starting to take shape. And you'd run through this building in my head millions of times, right? Because through the AutoCAD plans and everything. But to actually see it come up, we were getting ready to cast like the second slab, the third slab. And that night, that's when you actually start seeing the building come together. And the next day, I had an exam. And they asked me, like, okay, fine. Come up, we're going to cast the slab. So I had to choose between giving my exam or watching this labor of love come up in front of me. And I chose to not do the exam. And I went, we flew to Jaipur, slide. Stood in that courtyard, looked at that, and I had tears in my eyes because of all the hard work was coming through, and something was actually taking shape. Then things kept rolling. I think about a year and a half, stood in that same courtyard. Slide. We had a finished hospital. And after that, we got news that, you know, the hospital had been internationally accredited in terms of the functionality, in terms of service, in terms of, and I'd go back and the doctors were like, you know, it's a pleasure to work here, this and that, all such wonderful things. Slide. So from this slide, I went to that, right? So first project done. Hypothetical situation, only concepts, built in the real world. Massive project. Now, next project, I think all of you will be a little familiar with. Slide. Okay, let me get past this. So, there's a doctor here and with us. So, the doctors, when I worked in such small, close proximity with them, they have this philosophy called Occam's razor when they diagnose, which is usually the simplest solutions are most often the right solutions. And we kind of adopted this in our principles, in the way that we work. Always, you know, form is just a byproduct of how it works functionally, always. A lot of architects get carried away with the form and this and that, but eventually, if you plan well, if you design well, intelligently, the form will always justify the function. Right? Slide. Final year of architecture school, fifth year. Big boy, like, yeah, okay. We got a couple of projects rolling after the hospital. The Bengaluru International Airport had reached capacity, and they were looking to expand. Right? And they set up a competition called Vision Air for all the architecture students. Mostly it was most fifth years that took part. And we had about 2.5-3 months, me and one of my juniors. He's like, Shetty, we should go, we should take part. I was like, I have a lot of work, I have to submit my thesis, I have to do all of this. He's like, no, we should. So I'm like, okay, fine. And we had a 2-month time period to come up with designs for it. And for about a month and 3 weeks, we didn't do anything. Typical engineering architecture style, last minute. The week before, we came up with a slide. All right, so you all know the airport, so I'll just go through these. Slide. All right, so we came up with this sketch, right, the week before. And we were like, it just looks like a very fancy sketch to you, but for us, it was like, okay, fine, below you have the subway, you have connectivity, arrival, departure, all of that. But in its essence, the concept was this sketch. And we had maybe 3 days or 2.5-3 days to actually bring this to reality. So we worked really hard on it, got into all the 3D work and this and that. Slide. And we came up with this design. And we were thrilled with it because, you know, for us it was like, okay, it was super functional. It looked great. So obviously, you know, you need to sell it, and it was cost effective, it was very practical. At the same time, it was very ambitious. And we went and we presented the design. A lot of students from all over the city, almost 400 something entries. We got shortlisted. Final, we were up to like, there were only the 5 teams left. And we were like, yeah, we got this, I can feel it. Slide. And we lost. We came third. Slide. That's me and him in the background looking very sad. Right? So a week later, get a call from BIAL saying, listen, we know we gave you the third place, but your concepts were the most practical concepts. So we'd like you to come on board and help us in developing the new airport. So, slide. Thank you. This is, I'm sure you've seen these pictures whenever you fly out of Bangalore, you know, this is the new proposal. Just to show you how it evolved actually from our design. Slide. This is what we proposed. Slide. This is what's happening. Again. Slide. This is the sketch that I gave in. Slide. Another hypothetical situation into a massive, massive project. Right? Now we'll come down to a few smaller projects. Slide. Adaptive architecture. Now, India is a country, like you've heard from speakers before us, it's in a state of constant flux, constantly changing. One day you have this road is a one way, the next day it changes, it's the other way. If it starts raining, city comes to a standstill, no proper drainage, no proper anything. So the future of architecture is a building or a type of building that adapts rather than just stays like that and decays. So in all my time working in construction sites, you know, and interacting with laborers, speaking to them, trying to get their gist of it, you realize that their living conditions are atrocious. It's so poor and nobody cares. And the irony is they're the ones who are building our buildings, right? The biggest example of adaptive architecture, even though it's not functionally, it's very poor, are slums, right? Slide. On the left-hand side are the favelas in Brazil, and on the right-hand side are the Dharavi. Now, slums are actually adaptive architecture because it's made in a matter of days, and it withstands anything. Even though it does it very poorly, it withstands anything. So there's rain, flooding, rat infestation, all kinds of things, and these people live inside that. There are these huge tarpaulins, they cook inside, carbon monoxide poisoning, all of this happening. And I started to see a trend that in architecture, it's always about building the fanciest buildings, the most, you know, good-looking stuff, put a huge wall around it, and you're done. Nobody cares what happens to the social infrastructure of a city. Nobody cares about public spaces. That's the biggest problem. But now what's happening is, all of us are more well-read. The internet is a wonderful place. Everybody knows what's happening, how public spaces are used. So if you actually did design those spaces, it would be used a lot more than, for example, when in Chandigarh, Le Corbusier did it many years back, and it's not being used well now. So what we decided was, slide, give you an example. All of you know Baghmani Tech Park, right? So on the top of your screen, slide, is Baghmani Tech Park. Crores of rupees in construction, beautiful lake on the side, big roads. The pink mass that you see below is 200 slum families right there, which you don't see. And those are the slum families that helped build that. Slide. That green mass is the amount of trash that they create, which leads to malaria and all kinds of different kinds of, you know, diseases. So the entire problem is there is no adaptive housing for the slums. So what we did was, we've started this whole initiative where every new architecture commission we get, about close to 50% goes to two initiatives. One is we adopt children of slums and put them through school. The second is we subsidize, we're designing and subsidizing houses for slum dwellers that they can own, which you can set up and bring down in 6 hours and move anywhere you want. Take you through the project now. Slide. These are the families who we spoke to, and you know, those are the children that we're all putting through school now. We are up at 10 children. Next slide. Scaffolding poles. Scaffolding, everybody knows scaffolding? On the side of buildings to paint, to plaster. All right. Very, very cheap and made in excess. So we went, we approached the scaffolding people. We were like, listen, we want these many. A family of four lives in a 10 by 10 feet house, 100 square feet, a family of four. So you put up 9 poles, slide, you brace the poles, slide, take reclaimed jungle wood, create a raft which is 1 foot above the ground, so if there's any water, any rats, anything, it goes underneath, so there's no infestation. Slide. Instead of these big tarpaulins, you put bamboo. Bamboo is the most sustainable building material ever. It's cheap, it grows at an immensely fast rate, and it's super strong. So what it happens is, you create this porous wall. So there's always air circulation, there's fresh air coming in and coming out of the house, always. Slide. Sliding door. Next. Put a thatched roof so that you can collect rainwater. Flip it on its side. So you have this little bit sticking out in the back, which is where you can cook. That's one unit. So you put two units together, next, you get a pitched house. Put them all together, next, you get a slum housing, put up in 6 hours, which they can own at a really, really subsidized rate. And by the end of... By the end of the year, we're getting ready to roll out. We're actually speaking to local authorities and we're working with NGOs. By the end of the year, we're getting ready to roll out housing for 100 families. Right? Next slide. Coming to the last project. This was my final project at Columbia with a couple of my classmates. The task that was given to us was, what if you could design a space for the spoken word? For example, if you wanted to have a TEDx event, just like this one, in the middle of the desert, would you be able to design an infrastructure space for it? How would that happen? That was the design problem that was given to us. Slide. So these were the parameters we came up with. What if it had to be deployable, which means it could be go anywhere in the world, extremely low cost, all-inclusive, which means it had to be, you know, take care of itself, and it has to be flexible in terms of the different kinds of terrain that you'd be using it for. Slide. So that's a map of the world with all the shipping container routes, right? So we looked at this and we realized, okay, fine, it's already been figured out how to get something from one edge of the world to the other edge of the world, right? Because a shipping container, slide, it can be put on a boat or a barge, it can be airlifted, it can be put on the back of an 18-wheeler truck, it can be put at the back of a train. So that means there's nowhere in the world that it cannot get to. So we realized this is the most effective mode of getting our idea somewhere. So what if we could make this shipping container, how do we make the shipping container into an auditorium for 250 people, 300 people? How do you do it? You have so many moving parts, you have seats, you can't fit all of it. You'll have to send multiple shipping containers. So we're like, after months of working different permutations and combinations, slide. Next. We came up with this video. So a 40-foot shipping container is completely self-contained as an auditorium, a 250-seat auditorium. So in 4 hours, slide, it turns into a 250-seat auditorium completely. So what happens is you also have a complete shade sail. So slide, you can drop it in the middle of a desert, just like I said. The sail has photovoltaic cells sewn into the canvas, so it generates its own electricity. So you can feed the lighting, the audio equipment, the tech, everything through it. So you don't need a plug point. Slide. You have different configurations. You can use it half, you know, on the side of a hill. So it's very flexible in terms of how you can use it. Next. So started as a concept. We've gotten orders from New York, Copenhagen, London. I'm flying over all over the world. Kerala, the Kerala government wants to use it for the Commonwealth Games. And the response has been phenomenal. So we're going to get ready again. The prototype should be ready in another month, month and a half. All of these started. All right, so I'll just take you through. So basically, slide. It's like an IKEA catalog. So there's, next. It just tells you part A, part B. Part B goes here, part A goes there, and you can set it up. It's very simple. So all of these started as hypothetical situations, and now they're all being built for the real world. So I'd always like to end by not so much giving advice, because I feel like I'm still learning so much every day, and I'm getting to know it as I go along, but I'd like to leave you with what has worked for me, right? At the end of the day, all I did was work really hard and be very kind. And if you can follow those two things, amazing things will happen. The world will just come together and get you whatever you want. So that's what I'd like to leave you with. Thank you so much for your time.